Can anybody hear me? Okay, I think we're ready. The name of the song I'm singing is called I Will Go. It's one of my favorite songs. The words are very beautiful. Just pay attention to the words and let it speak to your heart. Let the Lord speak to your heart with this song. Nervous. Praise the Lord. But it's okay because that's the Holy Spirit, you know. Sometimes we just got to let God take control and He'll do the rest. Praise the Lord. Today I wanted to talk about a classic story in the Bible in Genesis, Cain and Abel. That story speaks a lot to my heart and it makes me see a picture of what's going on today in our world. We have two classes of people, two worshipers in the church. People that worship God in spirit and in truth, and people that worship God according to the commandments of men and the doctrines of men. You know, Cain and Abel, these two brothers grew up in a family, the pioneers of sinners. They were not very happy about that. but one chose one direction and the other chose another. Cain and Abel, like in many brother, like many families, they grew up knowing their parents, what their parents had done, how their parents had fallen to sin and had given dominion to the adversary of souls, causing pain and misery on earth. Before I go any further, I'd like to have a word of prayer so that the word will sink into our hearts. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father in heaven, we honor you, we worship you, we praise you, and we adore you. You are God, you're the Ancient of Days and the Adonai. We pray right now, Lord Jesus, that your Holy Spirit would just come and fall in this place. That, Lord Jesus, I would decrease and you would increase. And that, Lord Jesus, our hearts would be humble and we would accept your word of this day. Oh, Lord, I pray in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. But even though these brothers were both aware of their situation, both of these brothers ended up in two different directions. God tested both brothers in their loyalty to him. When Adam and Eve had sinned, God had instituted the sacrificial system of worship, the offering of a chosen animal, a way for his children to be cleansed from their sin and to help them to expect the first advent of Jesus Christ, their Redeemer, which the sacrifice represented. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. But Cain thought differently. And you know, with the things that God tells us to do, tests our faith in him and our obedience. It tests the gauge of the heart on whether we love God or we don't love God. The Bible says there's nothing impossible with God. And even if we had the attitude that Cain had, we can still convert and turn to the attitude that Abel had. Let's talk about, let's say Cain was living today. How do you think Cain would behave? You know, just because Cain didn't offer the right sacrifice doesn't mean he wasn't doing everything wrong or doing everything completely right. In the sense that he was going to church. You know, he probably was a deacon or an elder in church. He might have been. You know, he might have had a good personality, you know, but it makes a difference when you're not totally yielded to God. It makes a difference when some people don't have discernment, they can't see your heart. So, of course, they automatically assume that this person is righteous and is doing the right thing. But in closed doors, their heart is speaking something different. No separation from the world. Cain was not completely separated from his carnal nature, not in terms of his spirit. He was not completely separated with the nature that was against God. If Cain was living today, he would say, oh, there's nothing wrong with secular music. There's nothing wrong with movies. There's nothing wrong with, you know, speaking of things on the Sabbath that were inappropriate, not keeping the Sabbath holy. Cain probably had almost perfect attendance at church. He would greet you with a smile, but have hate in his heart for you because you did him wrong somewhere along the line. Living for God according to his own way, that's what I call the golden cow syndrome. Because since God is not satisfactory to you, or his demands or his precepts or principles, you may think it's too hard. You start to build your own God. And that attitude is you worship your own God, but you're not worshiping the true God. You're doing it on your own. You're making your own laws. You're saying, I can do this, and I can do this, and I'm going to choose not to do this, but not according to God. Saying nothing wrong with the incorrect courting practices, being sensual, participating in the world's way of courtship, or dating, as they would say. If Cain was living today, he would have been displaying a lot of these characteristics. Anything he wanted, he ate, not adhering to the health principles. He was cool and popular in church, outside of church. He was very well friends with the world, but having enmity with God. The Bible says when you are friends with the world, you have enmity with God. So Cain, basically, was not in close proximity with God. He did not have an obedient relationship with God. And we read from Genesis chapter 4, verse 3, and it says, and in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought the fruit of the ground and offered it unto the Lord. Now we read that God required blood and an animal. And he just took whatever he wanted to and gave it to God. That was like a slap in God's face, like the utmost disrespect. But God in his mercy still told him, look, if you behave well, I will bless you. I will approve of you. And this is a classic presentation of some of the characteristics that we have in this world, in the church, both young and old. There are some people who are pastors, all the way down to elders, deacons, and so on and so forth. People's hearts are not completely committed to God. And God sees that, and some people will see it too. Both of these brothers were doing the same thing at one point, but it came to the very end where there was a difference in worship. What was wrong with Cain's sacrifice? What was wrong with his attitude? You know, when we offer something to God, what is our attitude in our heart? Is it a thankful, gracious attitude, or is it a begrudging attitude? What did God ask for? It says in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 77, without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission of sin, and they were to show their faith in the blood of Christ as their promised atonement by offering the firstlings of the flock in sacrifice. Besides this, the first fruits of the earth were to be presented before the Lord as a thank offering. There is nothing wrong with the fruits or the production of the ground that Cain brought. But was it the correct offering? Was it the requirement that God asked for? The fruits was a thank offering. The lamb that was to be slain was the offering to cleanse them from the sins. Both Cain and Abel erected an altar. They were both doing the same thing to a certain point, which explains the two types of Christians in this world. There are Christians that want to worship God and live for God, and they want to do their devotion and pray and have a close communion with God. And there's some Christians that are just saying, you know, I can only do it to a certain extent, or I can only do so much. I want to live the way I want to live, having a form of godliness, but having no power because of their lifestyle. You know, you see them, they're shouting hallelujah. Some of them, you know, they're running around claiming to be Christians and so on and so forth, but deep down in their heart, they know that they're wanting in some way. And there's those Christians that are humbling themselves, knowing that they're sinners, and they want a close communion with God. Matthew 15:9, it says, but in vain do they worship me. God does not accept this kind of worship. Worship is not just about singing or raising your hands, but it's also about the way you live. And sometimes you don't have to open your mouth to worship God, and you don't have to testify with opening your mouth. All you have to do sometimes is just live the right life or live a certain way, and people will see what you're all about. And Cain did the same. He lived a certain way, and it showed how he had a grudge because of what happened, you know, because of what his parents did, because of his life. He was always bitter. And in Genesis 4:6-7, before I go, it says, God rejected his offering and reprimanded him, but he rejected God's mercy. And even then, God was so merciful not to strike him down. It said, and the Lord said unto Cain, Genesis 4:6-7, why art thou wroth, and why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. Because of Cain's hardened heart, he fell and eventually killed his brother. But the same way the Cains of today will persecute the Abels of today. Basically, if we have an attitude that Cain had, we're going to persecute our brothers. We're going to persecute our brothers in the church that want to do right. And there's always contention and there's always fightings in the church, because there's one side that has not totally yielded their life to God, and the other side, they want to yield their life to God. And of course, we know Satan is in the church too, trying to disorganize the church so it doesn't push through or doesn't push forward. The Cains of today run around the church, pews dancing, screaming, beating the drums hard, speaking in counterfeit tongues, praise dancing or miming, claiming to have the Holy Spirit, but have a nasty attitude, have a nasty lifestyle, eating, drinking, and drinking, which shows in their health, sleeping around, jumping from one man or woman to another, living in a very pretentious Christian life or experience, but they still claim to worship God, not knowing God has rejected their sacrifice and worship, the kings of the world. I'm sorry I didn't come here to make people smile. I just came here to bring the word of God. And that's what a lot of times is missing today. If we were told quite often to be careful to give God the glory, our churches would be in a better position today. But apparently, that's not so. But God is good because God is a very God has a sense of humor, and God will use someone that doesn't fit the criteria for a preacher, but like a football player or a bouncer at a club, you know, to be able to bring the message of God and to be able to speak and sing and so on and so forth, to show as a testimony that the power of God, what the power of God can do to someone's heart. In 2 Timothy 4:3-4 says, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears." It was so funny because our church today, the young generation, they do whatever they want, but they still proclaim Christ. You know, I heard someone say one time that they went to watch Twilight or Harry Potter. And what does that have to do with Christ? These are the kind of attitudes to where you will be like, well, you proclaim to be a Christian and Christ and so on and so forth, but you're basically supporting the very people that are against Christ. And if we take our worship to Christ, God doesn't accept it because our hands are stained with people's blood, because people are committing suicide and people are on drugs and people, you know, are all sorts of things because of these people that we are supporting. And God sees that and he doesn't accept the sacrifice. And our sacrifice is the way we live and the way we worship God and our character and so on and so forth. The kings of the world don't want to know how they can please God, but they want to know how little they can get by. But there is still very much hope for the kings of today. Is your lifestyle today like the lifestyle of Cain? Are you just living life and just maybe coming to church? And then when you get out of church, you do whatever you want. You're not really thinking much of God, but you're thinking a lot more of what you want to do, your pleasures, things that will gratify you. So that's the question of today. What is your life like? Well, you see, even Cain was not condemned because God still had an offering to return and convert his heart. God said, if you obey me, I will accept your offering. If you have faith in me, if you do it right, I'll accept your offering. So Cain was not condemned. The same attitude of today, we are not condemned. We still have a chance to turn around and serve the Lord. And God calls us even today. He's still knocking at our door and he's asking, when will you come to me? When will you give your life completely to me? And I work in a hospital setting. I work in the ER. And we are not too young to die. We're not too young to have strokes. You're not too young to have heart attacks. You're not too young for anything to suddenly happen to you and you die. Last night, they brought in a 25-year-old while he was playing soccer. He fell out of nowhere. We couldn't revive him. I was the last person to touch him, basically. He just died. And he was 25 years old. He didn't look too bad in terms of health. But it goes to show that tomorrow is not promised according to what the Bible says. We should make our calling and election sure when it comes to living for Christ. I know the world is extremely appealing. The reason why it's appealing is because we're all born in sin and shaped in iniquity. So we're formed and fashioned because of what our grandparents did, Adam and Eve. But we can still choose to be converted by Christ. So we have to make that choice, and we have to make that choice today. And I'm appealing to those that have not completely made that choice to make that choice today. Choose you this day whom you shall serve. For as me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And you know, it's very important because if you step out of this building, You know, according to the books in heaven, if your life is not going to change, there may be a decision made for your life to end at that certain point. In reference to Cain, Abel was just a normal young man, and he understood what his father had done in letting sin enter into the world. But the difference of Abel and his brother starts from the heart. Though Abel was a sinner, he accepted his lot, his circumstance, and had a repentant heart. It's not so much what you do anymore, it's the condition of your heart that will portray what you do. James 4, 8-9 says, "Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness." Now, I'm not saying go around walking with your head down and moping. But then when you repent and you give your life to God, your attitude should be an attitude of repentance. But when you walk around after you've spent that time with God, people will see the joy illuminating your face, like when Moses went up on the mountain. They will see something about you unwanted because they will see that you have peace and joy that passes all understanding. You see the people in this world and the people that show themselves like Hollywood, you see them having their extravagant life. They're beautiful. They're rich. But if you really dig deep and see what really goes on in their life, there's a lot of pain. There's a lot of suffering. There are many prices that they've paid because of their sins. One example I like to use is David. You know, David was a man after God's own heart, but he made mistakes. And the mistakes David made were very bad mistakes. He killed his best general for his wife because he slept with his wife. And he hid it for a long time. It was about over a year. And he did not repent till God showed him by the prophet Nathan that he had error, or he had erred in his ruling. And he paid the price. His first son died from Bathsheba. Amnon died. Someone else died in his family. There's a lot of his son Amnon turned against him. He had so many problems because of that very sin. And when you sin, it affects everyone. When you live a life that is unjust and unruly, it affects everyone, your family, because everyone is affected. Sin is not an individual thing. Because when you sin, it affects your friends, it affects your family, it affects your church. It affects your job, it affects your world. And we have to be careful, but you see, the hope and of the matter is God can make things a little better. When you give your life to Him, He starts to fix things. And that's our only hope, is Jesus Christ. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, when we just hold His hand and say, "Lord, take me and convert me and change my heart," He starts to get busy and He starts to fix things. First, He sends His Holy Spirit to work in your heart, and then He'll change you into a totally different person, and He'll redeem you. Now, because Abel humbled himself and obeyed God's requirements, he found joy in a relationship with God. Hebrews 11:6 says, "But without faith it is impossible to please Him, for he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him." Abel may have not been perfect, but he was on his way there. Just by his surrender to God, his heart was in the right place. Hebrews 11:4 says, "By faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gift, and by it he being dead yet speaketh." Even in his death, his story still speaks to us in faithfulness. And we have to humble ourselves because of the position we're in. There should be no pride in our lives, so that God will take us and humble us. But the awesomeness of the gospel is that there is both hope for the Abels of this world and the Cains of this world. We don't all have to fall in that category of Cain. We can fall into the category of the great patriarchs who had faith in God and live for God. So again, I invite and I ask that please we would look into our hearts and say, if Jesus was to come in a few minutes, would we be prepared to meet Him? Would our attitude allow us to pass through those gates? Because the same attitude that you have now is the same attitude you'll carry into heaven. So it behooves us to allow God to fix our characteristics to conform to His image. We were originally created in the image of God. But because of sin, we have now the image of someone else. But God can restore that image if we just let Him. The process of sanctification is a lifetime. And if you're not allowing God now to start working on your heart, when Jesus comes, you'll not have the chance to say, okay, Lord, I give my life to you. No, because you're already set in your ways. It says in 1 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning His promises, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. God can save to the uttermost to those who believe in Christ. And God loves us all. He loved Cain. He loved Abel the same. He loved Adam. He loved Eve the same, even after their sin. He loved David after his sin. Even Manasseh, who killed the prophets and stoned them, even at his deathbed or his persecution, he was saved. Isaiah 1:18-20 says, come now, let us reason together. That's Isaiah 1:18-20. God speaks to us even now. It says, come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. And if you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. It is us that has to make the choice. God is already waiting for us so that He can take our hearts and mold it and shape it. God is looking for people that will preach the gospel and bring people into the church, bring people into the truth. And He wants to use us. And unfortunately, the devil has his poor tactics that appeal to the sensual, carnal nature that brings us to his lot. When God wants to bring us to a higher plane of existence with the gospel and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So I'm just calling out today, and I'm asking, is your heart right with God today? And if your heart is not right with God today, and you've been living a certain way that is not agreeable with Jesus himself, you should make a change. Allow God to enter your heart and to change you. Naturally, we don't have the desire to want to change. God has to give you that desire. It's called the gift of repentance. I'm just asking that you pray to God and ask God, Lord, please give me that desire. Give me the gift of repentance. Change my heart and convert me completely and use me for your kingdom. And if you have that desire to say that, you can come up front. You can stand where you are and we can have a word of prayer. Because if Jesus comes and you're not amongst the number, Ellen G. White writes in her books that you'll wish that you'd listen. You would see all the opportunities that you had to change and you rejected, and how God held out His arms of love and called you out while you rejected Him. If you want to make that decision, you can stand up and we can pray for you that your life may be conformed to God's image. See, God loves you and He doesn't want you to perish. He wants your heart to be transformed into His heart. He wants His ways to be your ways. But if we allow the devil to, use us against His kingdom, we will not make it. There is no dividend. There is no dividing. There is no middle ground. The only ground that we should stand on is the life and the foundation of Christ. Let's have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, we just wanted to come and say glory to you in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna. You have saved us from our iniquity and our sins. And Father, we stand as the Israelites stood before the mountain as you spoke to them. Lord Jesus, making a covenant, a promise. And Father, we give our lives to you to worship you and to honor you so that we can pull it away from the devil's hands. We honor you and we glorify you because you're the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, and the God of Moses, the great God of all gods. Father, there's some people here that want to recommit their lives, and there's some people here that want to give their lives. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you look into their hearts and change them, O Lord, I pray. For we're all born in sin and shaped in iniquity. You said, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, Father. You said, if we trust in you, Lord Jesus, if we have faith in you, Lord Jesus, that you'll bring it to pass. Father, we love you and we worship and praise you. Even into my heart, please look and cleanse thou me from secret faults. Prevent me from presumptuous sin. Cleanse all of us, O Lord, I pray. And then, like the day of Pentecost, let your Holy Spirit fall upon us and give us the strength to live this life continuously so that when people see us, they'll know that we belong to you and want to know how they can get that peace and joy. Father, we love you, we honor you because you loved us first. You died on the cross for us, Lord Jesus, and you gave your only Son. And he's now changed forever at a certain point because of us, Father. He had the nails in his legs and the nails in his hands. I pray, Lord Jesus, that we'd always keep that in our mind, that you died for us and you loved us so much. But Father, help us to live this life with the desire from the Holy Spirit completely to serve you. And may we offer sacrifices of joy with our lifestyle, with our speech, with our ways to glorify you. We love you and we worship and we praise you. And Lord Jesus, that those that want to give their life completely would speak to the pastor of the church. And that, Lord Jesus, that they'll make their election confirmed. I pray these things by the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. Amen.